Coast capital known as the Big Apple.
Send it in, Big Fella.
New York City. The streets stay gritty, feel the electricity. New York City.
The juice of the concrete jungle.
He exploded to the bucket. The
energy, aggression, and life. It's taken these teams this far, they've just begun to fight.
Big city of life, so nice, they said it twice. Where the only way to win is sweat and sacrifice. It's just a state of mind. Everything you need for success you can find.
Nova's had Marquette's number, baby, but not by much. Evenly matched, evenly motivated. In the Big East Championship.
Oh my goodness! Woo-hoo! Attacking the 10!
It was the East Coast capital known as the Big Apple. New York City!
It's a Thursday in New York City, a town where the best thrive under pressure. And those who can't take the heat of the hectic pace find themselves leaving town. That's always the case in Madison Square Garden during Championship Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Day three of the Big East Championship presented by New York Life. 9 teams have gone home, 7 still remain for now. Villanova and Marquette square off next. It's a series where recently every game has gone down to the wire. Marquette played yesterday, holding off a furious second-half rally by St. John's. Earlier today, Georgetown, after losing twice to Syracuse during the regular season, finally got the orange. And two games tonight as well. 7 Eastern, ESPN, Notre Dame, Pitt, West Virginia, Cincinnati at 9. Hi, everybody, with Fran Fraschilla, Doris Burke. I'm Dave Pasch. Beth Moen's here as well. Guys, Villanova was off to a 9-0 start in Big East play, but then went 4-5 down the stretch. We'll see if they can bounce back.
Well, that can happen in this league, but Jay Wright also juggled his lineup a little bit, went big. We'll see how that works against the small and pesky Golden Eagles.
Conversely, Marquette got off to a slow start, Doris, in league play, but has won 10 of its last 12, including yesterday.
Well, if you include yesterday's game, 12 of their games have been decided by 3 points or less. They're very comfortable. We would anticipate that kind of matchup with Villanova.
All right, let's talk star watch. You can't talk about stars for Villanova without mentioning Scotty Reynolds.
Well, number 2 all-time on Villanova's scoring list. Trying to catch Kerry Kittles before the end of his unbelievable career. Started as a freshman, and ever since he has been the go-to guy for Jay Wright.
Lazar Hayward epitomizes what a Buzz Williams player is. He makes winning plays. He's committed to the scout. He lays the screen that gives the decisive three-point basket, and then sits on DJ Kennedy's left hand to help them secure the win against St. John's.
Hayward had 20 points, 9 rebounds in the win yesterday for Marquette. Kubion was big in that game as well, had 3 threes. He's joined by Acker and Johnson Odom, 2 of the best shooters in the Big East from 3. Jimmy Butler barely played yesterday because of foul trouble. He's had a couple of game-winning shots this year. And for Villanova, team that got off to a 20-1 start, Reynolds, Fisher, who's from the Bronx, Redding, Muftal Yeru back in the starting lineup. At the center position along with Antonio Pena, Yeru started the year. And then came down with hepatitis B, then came back and gave Villanova another weapon. John Cal, John Gaffney, Earl Walton are referees for this game. Villanova beat Marquette in the quarterfinals by a point. Scotty Reynolds had a game winner in Milwaukee this year for Villanova against Marquette. And their other meeting during the regular season came down to the final seconds also. Yeru looked like he touched it last, and it is Marquette basketball to start the game.
It's going to be interesting, guys, because Villanova has gone big at the end of the year with Yeru. And while it may help them offensively, it's going to be interesting to see how Pena and Yeru guard the mobility of Butler and Hayward.
There's Johnson Odom off the bounce. And he struggled yesterday, just 7 points, and misses his first shot here. Reynolds facing an early double team. Butler got a hand on the pass and then poked out of bounds by Hayward. It's going to
going to be interesting, Doris, because Scotty Reynolds and Corey Fisher are great in the pick and roll, but these guys in that backcourt for Marquette are junkyard dogs defensively.
Here's Fisher, very good at getting into the lane. He can't get the shot, but he's fouled.
Well, they're going to get their opportunity to guard that pick and roll, that's for sure.
Jay Wright, two-time Big East Coach of the Year in his ninth season at Villanova. Has not been to a Big East tournament title game, by the way. Villanova's only won one. That was back in 1995 with Kerry Kittles. And Steve Lapis is the head coach. Always on Kubion.
Probably a more talented pick and roll than the one they saw yesterday as well.
Haney with a rebound after the two misses by Fisher. Shoots close to 80% from the free throw line.
See, early in the year, they were four out. It gave them better driving opportunities. Now with two big guys, they have less space to create.
Hayward on the drive. Tough shot. Wouldn't drop. And Reggie Redding gets to the loose ball. Scotty Reynolds, third in the Big East in conference games in scoring, just under 20 points per game. A very efficient year for Reynolds, shooting the basketball as well as distributing. Redding, who had the pass to Dwayne Anderson for the game-winning basket at the Big East tournament last year against Marquette, hits the first hoop today.
Some of that efficiency for Scotty Reynolds has to do with the product of the quality of shots. I mean, so many times last year and over the course of his career, he was put in positions to have to go with the shot clock running down and make tough shots.
And that will never help your field goal percentage for sure.
Kubion on the drive, contact and a blocking foul called on Fisher. First foul in the game on him. Buzz Williams done a terrific job in his second year as the head coach of Marquette, 37 years of age.
I think Coach Boeheim certainly deserved Coach of the Year. If I was going to pick a co-coach of the year, it'd be this guy right here.
Marvelous job. They lost 5,400 points. When you think of guys like Dominique James and Wesley Matthews and Jarrell McNeil. Yes. Now, you guys know I'm a basketball junkie. I had never heard of Darius Johnson, Odom, or Dwight Bikes before this season. And it took Orlando, the Old Spice tournament, before I said, uh-oh, these guys are pretty good.
Yeah, you and I have been talking since late December about how impressive Buzz Williams' practice was. He is an attention-to-detail guy. You are not going to outwork him or his players.
He was an assistant under Tom Crean after leaving his post as the head coach at New Orleans. Must have known something nobody else did about that program. And also about Tom Crean leaving the following year for Indiana. Johnson on a block by Yarrell. What a play. And here's Pena on the other end. Great sequence for the Wildcats.
Jay Wright told me 2 weeks ago he didn't think they'd be the team they could be without more size inside. You saw Yarrell on one end, Pena on the other.
Villanova Final Four team last year. Bikes shot hits the side of the backboard there. Reynolds in transition. Got it!
Now you saw Andy Routens in your last game, and now you're looking at one of those poised, experienced, been through just about everything you can be through kind of guards in college basketball. That is Scotty Reynolds.
Reynolds, second all-time leading scorer at Villanova. Lazar Hayward, such a dangerous player. That's a three.
And he is going to create some mismatches today for Villanova if Pena and Yarrell stay on the court a long time.
Hayward hit six threes in the regular season in the two meetings with Villanova. Reynolds on Acker. Clock at 10. Yarrell finds Pena. Boy, is he improved. Doubling his scoring average from a year ago.
Just like Dante Cunningham, the bigs slowly but surely improve their skills, find a way to be effective inside a guard-oriented offense.
Tucker off the bounce. Way off with that shot. Last touch, though, by Fisher. And into the game, Corey Stokes. Not started now, four straight games.
But they match down now, Dave, as you notice. Yarou goes out, so they go to the smaller lineup. And this will be more effective offensively for them because Pena will become the designated screener in that four-out offense.
Becomes a little bit more spread out. You put a little bit more pressure on your ability to keep the ball in front of you.
They're looking to see whether the last shot hit the rim. They reset the shot clock, so they believe that it did, but they'll take a look.
I didn't think it hit the rim. Didn't it hit the side of the backboard? Oh, it did. Yep. Just grazed it. Any way you look at it, it wasn't looks, pretty. Show me any angle you want.
That looks like Dave's jump shot.
Hey, no.
This is a Villanova team trying to get its mojo back, and obviously they had a difficult out in the Big East Conference. They faced their test late in the year.
Remember the special teams, they love to score on inbounds plays.
They do reset the shot clock. Winner of this game will play Georgetown after the Hoyas beat Syracuse, and the three for Kubion.
I know what you're thinking, Doris. They didn't score in an inbounds play, but I love the flow into the offense.
Yes, yes. Good execution. I looked at you like, I don't know. Can we count that a score off an inbound?
Here's Pena. Tried to make the pass to Redding, intercepted by Butler. Hayward calling for it. Instead, Butler finds Bikes. He'll pull the trigger. Spins out the three. Reynolds ahead to Fisher. He'll pull up for a two. Long rebound to Stokes, who's had some big games at the Big East tournament. He likes playing here at the Garden, right on cue with a three. He had 20 against Marquette last year. 2 years ago against Syracuse, he had 22 here in New York. He's from New Jersey, went to St. Benedict's.
Hey, he played with David Kubion, same team.
Hayward. Shot clock at 10 for Kubion. Bikes. Two on the shot clock. Acker to Hayward. What a great job by Marquette to be patient there, huh?
You know what's amazing? They don't have a post guy that can score it, but they get points in the paint the hard way, all off of dribble penetration.
Villanova talked about not getting caught up in made threes by Marquette, which you can do. They said, well, our key is we don't want to foul them.
Reynolds, no. There is some contact. Wanted a foul, but did not get the call. Here's Bikes leaving it for Kubion, and then he threw it into the backcourt.
Well, Jay Wright added another component at the end of the year. Mouf Yarou battling back from hepatitis B. But that young man is healthy, and he'll help him in the NCAA tournament. You can count on that.
But I won't rest till I'm giving my respect, and my vision isn't set on the money I get. But more.
Villanova by two. Georgetown awaits the winner of this game. The Hoyas beat Syracuse. So the Orange, do they lose a number one seed? Do they lose one of their starters, Arinze Onuwaku? Here's Jim Boeheim with the latest.
Well, he's got a strain. We don't know for sure if it's any more than that. We'll find out Monday. We'll try to find out tomorrow when we go home, get the MRI tomorrow.
Here's the injury by Onuwaku as he challenged Monroe. Hard to see there if it happened on the contact or as Onuwaku hit the deck. Checking with Beth Mullins for more.
Well, it was a rather somber mood. I just came from the Syracuse locker room, Dave, and obviously they're disappointed with the loss, but also about the uncertainty surrounding their teammate. Orenzo Onuwaku was walking around in crutches. The team is scheduled to fly back to Syracuse tomorrow morning, and that's where they expect to get the MRI done tomorrow. I did have a chance to speak briefly with Andy Routens, his teammate, who was the first on the scene here, just a few steps away from where I'm standing, where the injury occurred. He said, obviously, they're disappointed and hoping for the best. And he said, hey, we had to pick each other up after Wes Johnson got hurt. We hope we don't have to do it again, but if we do, everybody's got to step up.
All right, Beth, Fran and Doris, that coupled with losing two in a row, does, how much of an impact does that have on Syracuse's seed in the NCAA tournament?
I think it's definitely a factor, but I think Doris made the point during the game of the season-long success of Syracuse will mitigate the circumstances of a loss today. A lot of it will depend on other teams and other conferences.
And if Onuwaku is hurt during the NCAA tournament, Syracuse would be down to six players, really.
And you test the notion that they have seven starters, but it drastically changes the kind of book and matchups in the interior. We saw Greg Monroe late get a rebound against Chris Joseph that he might not have gotten on a walk we were in the game.
Johnson Odom with two on the shot clock. That's two straight field goals for Marquette with time running out on the shot clock.
One thing the teams look at with Villanova is they want to score usually in the first 10 seconds, so they'd love to turn you over and get transition opportunities. I think they want to see if they want to guard for the full shot clock.
Taylor King playing. He did not play in Villanova's last regular season game because Jay Wright said he had a, quote, personal issue. But they straightened that out, and King eligible now for the Big East Championship. Butler out to Johnson Odom. Same spot, same result, the three. Timeout, Villanova. Eight straight points for the Golden Eagles. Darius Johnson Odom, a junior college All-American a year ago. Second in the Big East during the regular season in three-point shooting at 48%. And so far in this game, he's got two triples.
What makes him so effective, and we've seen this, Doris, during the year, his ability to get into the lane as well. He's a freight train once he puts it on a deck.
Reynolds with a pull-up three. Too strong. Rebound, though, by Stokes. Right back up, flipping it in. You mentioned he's had some big games in previous years. Can that confidence carry over from one Big East championship to the next, you think?
Oh, I don't think there's any question. There's certain guys, and he's a shooter, first and foremost. And there's certain guys, you get to a gym, you know you shot well there before. They're superstitious by nature.
He's got five quick ones off the bench.
See, Taylor King will do this during the year. He's guarding Acker on that possession.
Kubion. John Cal takes a seat as Kubion runs into him. He's okay. Both of them are. And Villanova foul. Marquette, two-point lead on the Wildcats. They get King for the personal. Back at the Garden, Marquette getting a lot of paint touches, but also getting some open looks. Maybe because of the paint touches, they're 4 of 5 from three-point land.
Well, that's exactly right. If you sit by the Marquette bench, you'll hear Buzz Williams say every possession, paint touches, paint touches. Here's Jimmy Butler. He draws the defense, and now the kick out. And they don't have the traditional postman, but don't think getting the ball into the lane doesn't open up some three-point opportunities.
We saw the success Georgetown had in beating that vaunted Syracuse zone, doing exactly that. Paint touches are important. It's set up 5 assists now on 5 field goals, and Buzz Williams is a numbers guy. He's also a man of incredible routine, almost a little OCD, he'll tell you. 3 days out to a game, 2 days out, 1 game out. Everything is routine and ritual with this guy.
Remember, Doris, he doesn't meet you at 1 o'clock. He meets you at 1:13.
Yes, yes.
Georgetown awaits the winner after beating Syracuse, and Pete Thamelou does an outstanding job. The New York Times has tweeted that Orenzo Onuwaku's mother told him that x-rays were negative on Onuwaku's right leg, and that, quote, he's fine, he'll be back for the NCAA tournament, as there's a Villanova foul. You heard Jim Boeheim say that they'll further evaluate it, and that right now it's a knee strain.
That's one of those situations where you hope mother knows best.
Well, when he heard it, the one thing you did not see is him land and the knee turn in an awkward position. And the first test they did, the trainer, was to check the stability of that knee. But that's your concern, that it's some sort of ligament tear.
Johnson Odom gets them both. Yeah. He's got 8 points already.
He's a sophomore, boy. I can't wait to watch him the next couple of years.
And Marquette pushing up on Villanova. And again, because Buzz is such a numbers guy, the first time he played him, the high percentage of times Villanova wanted to score in the first 10 seconds of the clock. He wants to disrupt them, take them out of their rhythm.
Here's Stokes, very confident, gets the bounce. He's got eight. More than half of Villanova, or just at half of Villanova's total.
See, now in his mind, he's sitting there going, see, I'm in Madison Square Garden. Those are the bounces I get.
Averaging 13 points per game over his career here at the Big East Championship. Gets Villanova within one.
Oh, good switch.
Again, Marquette very patient offensively. Johnson Odom has got the hot hand for the Golden Eagles. He's got 11. After just 7 yesterday.
He can get it going,
yeah,
Fran.
Yes, he can. He won a state championship in high school. He played at the vaunted Patterson School with Courtney Fortson and Texas's Varez Ward in the backcourt.
He's got the last 11 points for Marquette. Yeru in trouble. Gets it out to Cheek, who finds Reynolds, and he's fouled by Acker. Reynolds will walk away. First on Acker, second on Marquette.
You guys know how hard it is to shoot almost 50% from behind the arc in the Big East with all the defenders that come at you. That's amazing.
But what? How do you get that shot off? The solid screen by his teammate. You were talking yesterday about the execution culture. These guys are locked in on both ends on how they're going to get their shots and how they're going to prohibit their opponent's shots.
This is Johnson Odom's 16th game this year with at least 3 threes. You saw Reynolds go to the bench. They've got Malik Waynes, a freshman from Philadelphia, McDonald's All-American at the point. Fisher out there as well. Waynes can't handle the pass. Hayward's got it for Marquette. Johnson Odom, same spot. And misses that time.
That's that free one you get when you made three in a row.
Fisher in trouble in the lane. A lot of hands for Marquette. Great hustle by Fisher. Look at Buzz Williams on the baseline over here. Far right side of your picture as there's a foul inside on Marquette.
Is that in the coaching box?
Blocking the view of the cameramen working hard there on the baseline as Hayward picks up his first foul, third on the Golden Eagle.
Let's see, is John Kelsey. Yeah, he's pointing to the baseline saying you got to get over there.
And he was almost under the basket.
Hey, he's got a good view from there.
This isn't Vanderbilt. You've got to be over on the side of the court. Waynes facing the double team, backs out of it and throws it away, trying to hit Cheek. Marquette by 4 over Villanova midway through the first half. Winner advances to play Georgetown in the semifinals tomorrow night, 7 Eastern on ESPN. Dave Pasch, Fran Fraschilla, Doris Burke, and Beth Mowens. And right now the story is Darius Johnson Odom playing in his first Big East championship. Held to 7 points yesterday, but already has 11. In fact, the last 11 for Marquette. Hayward trying to fight through the double team in a Villanova foul. It's fourth team foul, first on Malik Waynes.
Well, I haven't seen too many teams double team Lazar Hayward that far from the basket this year. But Doris, if you take the ball out of his hands, that's probably a good thing.
Make somebody else make plays. And why not come with that strategy, knowing, as Dave has documented all game, it was a struggle yesterday for Johnson Odom. Shots, jump shots become a little bit tougher to make the deeper you get into March.
Here's Kubion. And he gets the friendly bounce. Senior from Venezuela.
Yeah. The two former high school teammates, Corey Stokes on one end for Villanova, and David Kubian. They both played for Danny Hurley, who was the outstanding Seton Hall star back in his day.
Redding shot in and out, and accurate, 5'8" tall, gets the rebound. Here's Butler to the corner. Offensive foul on Jimmy Butler. His first. He only played 2 minutes in the first half yesterday because he got a couple of quick fouls.
When Jimmy Butler gets to the foul line, second most in this conference behind Dominique Jones. So he's an attacker and a slasher, but you got to make sure you're under control. Looked like a little slide under there.
What do you think there? Could that be a play on?
I think it's got to be called something. I mean, I know we're not in the Big East regular season where no autopsy, no foul. But as you get ready for conference play, that's got to be a block or a charge. NCAA play, I should say.
Redding, no, on the drive. Cadogan got the rebound. Here's Hayward. 5 points so far in this game. Makes the pass. Cadogan with the floater. Way off the mark. Stokes got the board. Pena could not handle it. It'll go to Marquette. Golden Eagles with a 6-point lead on Villanova here in New York City. Here, Marquette on top of Villanova by 6. The Golden Eagles are 5 of 7 from three-point land. They're one of the best three-point shooting teams in the country. Hayward got his own miss. A beautiful tip.
That shot almost got blocked from behind. But I always thought the best offensive rebounders are the guys that shoot the ball because they know where their miss is going.
Lost it out of bounds.
Well, Lazar Hayward felt some pressure from behind. Jump stop to him. He is, as Franny likes to say, the classic mismatch four. Gets inside the free throw line. Nobody checks out for Villanova. And it's interesting, as you talked about the lineup switches, Jay Wright said as late as last week, I thought I'd have this figured out by now. We've got a lineup that's a good rebounding team, one that's a good defensive team, one that's a good offensive team. But he's still trying to pull the strings of the puppet. I'm not sure he knows at this point what's his best lineup at all times in the game.
I think they were 20-1 with the small lineup, the lineup that features Reggie Redding right now inside, but you see the problem that presents.
Hayward, great catch and pass to Butler, who's fouled. Johnson Odom back on the floor, by the way, from Marquette after a brief rest. 5th Villanova team foul, 2nd on Corey Fisher. Guys, how concerned are you about Villanova in the NCAA tournament because of the fact that they're just 2-4 in their last 6 and struggling here in the first half?
I think it's a concern. I think Jay Wright knows his team, and he knows he needs size to be able to combat teams like the Syracuses, the Kansases. But having said that, his best offensive team for much of the year, the team with the best flow, is when they go 4 outdoors and 1 in. And think about football, Dave. You want to get your playmakers in space. When they go to the big lineup, they have less space for guys like Corey Fisher and Scotty Reynolds to operate.
They started the Big East season, guys, 9-0. But 5 of their last 9 were top 20. They had 4 in the top 10. So their opponents down the stretch, and he said it, this league gets you eventually. Our bump in the road came late.
They've been in the top 10 all year. They were number 2 at one point, their highest ranking ever. Here's Kubian to Acker. After Villanova comes up with an empty possession, Johnson Odom off the mark, Redding clears. Giroux working on Hayward. Wayne's top shot, got it to drop.
That first matchup between these two teams, Doris and I saw Malik Wayne's get 16 and didn't play like a freshman that night.
Recently named to the All-Big East rookie team, Malik Wayne's. There's Butler on the move. to Odom with a great pass. Hayward can't get it to spin home. Here's Reynolds in the lane. Somehow scooped it up and in.
That's old school. I saw Earl Monroe do that about 35 years ago. That is old school.
And vintage Scotty Reynolds.
He's had some struggles here at the Big East Championship. His shooting percentage is under 35%. Lifetime here in New York at the Big East Tournament. But again, he's had a much more efficient season. We'll see if it continues today. Hayward, too strong from three. Villanova ball down five. Waynes, Hayward with a foul. That's two on Lazar Hayward.
Well, Malik Waynes has been a catalyst here the last minute, Doris, but take a look. We talk about Scotty Reynolds, the four-year guy. Little up and under. He knows full. Was it Kubion don't want a foul?
Is that a travel, guys?
I don't know. I know I saw Earl Monroe do that. Earl the Pearl.
Villanova uses the jump stop consistently through its lineup as well as anybody in the country. You'll see Pena do it. You'll see any of their bigs do it, and their guards are exceptional at it. It's one of Corey Fisher's most effective moves when he gets in the lane.
Yeah, that's such a great point, Doris, because if you have a team that attacks off the dribble, and that's going to be a primary part of your offense, and when you get deep in the lane, you've got to be under control.
You also have to go up with power because, generally speaking, you're going to be going up against bigger players, particularly their guards, so you need as much power as you can generate.
Villanova back within three, and they're going to get it as Pulse could not handle the pass in the corner. Buzz already sweating. By halftime yesterday, needed a new shirt. He ripped off that sport coat on his way back to the locker room. He is as intense as they come in practice at shoot around and, of course, in game.
Thad Mata is another one. Their suits cannot last long.
Waynes kept the pivot foot down. Yeru couldn't handle the pass. Bikes got it for Marquette. Buzz Williams started out UT Arlington making $400 a week for Coach Eddie McCarter. His mentor is a guy by the name of Lewis Orr, different from the Syracuse Lewis Orr. This guy is in the Junior College Hall of Fame. Coached at Navarro. He's a consultant for Buzz on a lot of issues. Williams just 37 years old, but certainly a rising star in the coaching ranks as Reynolds is pushed before the shot, no basket. Two on Acker.
I think the most amazing thing to me is the way Buzz Williams took over this program seamlessly from Tom Crean, who left to go to Indiana. And last year, Doris, it couldn't have been easy that he had to coach three seniors who had been set in their ways somewhat, but he has such a humanity about him. I mentioned it yesterday. The players absolutely love playing for him, despite the fact he puts them through the ringer.
Well, Jim Callahan said it best. He said, I'm not sure they have the fifth best talent, but it's amazing when you put great enthusiasm with great effort, what can be achieved.
Good hands by Johnson Odom defending Reynolds. Intercepting that inbounds pass. Marquette struggling, though, recently offensively, just one of its last seven from the field.
I think Villanova has really guarded that dribble drive a lot better this last 7 minutes.
Five to shoot. Here's Johnson Odom with two. Fulce. In and out. Rebound Pena.
That ball didn't touch the paint until the 33rd second on the shot clock.
Chance for Villanova to maybe tie it with this three. No. Waynes off the mark. Pulse with the ball. Johnson Odom swooping through the lane to Kubion. Both teams missing now. Reynolds. Great pick by Kubion. And then a foul by Reynolds. He and Kubion have been going at it throughout this game, and the officials step in quickly before there's any extracurricular activity. First foul on Scotty Reynolds. Both teams recognize the importance of play entering the NCAA tournament. A lot of intensity here in New York. How severe the injury is and whether he'll be able to go, but again, according to his mom, reports say that he'll be fine. And the Syracuse really playing only seven guys. If he's able to go, that's huge for them.
They've turned it over 10 times and only trailed by three.
Butler leaning in, gets it to go.
You talk about most improved players in the league, and Jimmy Butler would be in that conversation. And what I love about him is he knows how to use his body. Gets to the foul line an awful lot. He draws contact.
Stokes, an open three. He loves the garden. Corey Stokes with 11 points off the bench, his third three-pointer.
Now, he's a catch-and-shoot guy. You do not want to leave him in that particular instance. You want to get into his body and make him put it on the deck.
At 20 in the win against Marquette in the quarterfinals last year in a one-point victory. False. Way off. I don't know if he was going for the dunk or the layup. Maybe he didn't know. Villanova can tie it or maybe take the lead inside of 2 minutes to go in the first half. Winner plays Georgetown in the semifinals tomorrow night. Great move by Corey Fisher. The Bronx native has it tied at 28.
Now Marquette, if you're going to trap the basketball out front, somebody has got to rotate to the top. The scout on score to Corey Stokes is he's a catch-and-shoot guy. And Buzz Williams, he is digging into his guys.
Well, we mentioned he is as intense as they come. Case in point right there.
Well, if you're an execution culture, you know the scout. This is your catch-and-shoot guy, so you don't leave him uncontested. The other guy is a dribble driver. Fisher. He wants to get off the bounce. So you know the scout. He goes through four blue jerseys. You want to know why that coach is tearing him up? Those two plays.
Well, that's five quick points. And I'll tell you, Corey Fisher is almost impossible to keep out of the lane. Yeah. On the playgrounds in New York, they call him Fisher Price because of the way he toys with guys. But he and Scotty Reynolds are so good at getting to the foul line because of that use of the dribble.
And the bench points 15, mainly because of Corey Stokes. It was 9 for his last 15, by the way, from three-point land over the last three games. He's been better since coming off the bench with Yarus starting. Waynes gets the rebound after the Butler miss. Wildcats looking to take the lead.
Well, that's legal.
Reynolds makes the pass to the open man, but Stokes can't hit it this time. His first miss from three-point land. Johnson Odom leaning in. And Fulce hits the jumper.
Whatever Joseph Fulce did wrong, that drew Buzz Williams' ire during that timeout, that made up for a little bit.
How effective is Johnson Odom's up fake? I'm telling you, reminds me of Sam Young.
Great move by Waynes to the basket, giving Jay Wright quality minutes and giving Buzz Williams headaches here in the first half.
Not sure Jay Wright for the rest of his career is going to go into a season without three or four breakdown guards. You go back to the Randy Foy, Allen Ray, Kyle Lowry days, and this is the way they play.
They're guard you. Penn State was linebacker you. Villanova's guard you.
Oh, Jay's going to love you when you help with that recruiting, Hope Doris.
Johnson on him with 8 to shoot. Off the mark. Fulce gets to the loose ball. Marquette's got plenty of time. They didn't need that. And Kubion way off. And then Fulce knocks it out of bounds. A rookie mistake by a veteran. They had 10 seconds left. And because it hit the rim, the shot clock was not winding down. It was off.
Guys, I'd be very surprised here if Corey Fisher can't get into the lane. Now Marquette's going to come with a little bit of pressure.
Here's Fisher, the New York native, with one. Blocked by Fulce to end the half. Villanova with a 13-4 run to end the first half. We're tied at 30. Beth Mullen standing by with Villanova coach Jay Wright.
Jay, you talked before the game with your guys about not being tentative today against their three-point shooters. How do you think they fared in the first half?
All right, but I think we're a little tentative. You know, once they start knocking them out like that, then you're afraid to help. We don't rotate well. They do a great job of moving the ball. You got to give them credit.
How important was the bench support that you've gotten here in the first 20 minutes?
Malik Wayans was great. And Dominic Cheek gave us good minutes off the bench. Stokes comes off the bench, gives us good minutes. We've got good depth. But these guys, Marquette's used to playing 40 minutes. They've done it all year. So we got to keep our big guys in there. And we got to stop the threes, man, somehow.
All right, thank you.
Yeah.
And how about the different emotions from the head coaches? Jay Wright smiling, doesn't appear to be sweating at all through that beautiful suit, while Buzz Williams is ready to tear somebody's head off and sweating profusely in this intense game between Villanova and Marquette. We're tied at 30 at halftime. The Cisco Halftime Report is now with John, Doug, and Jay.
Pressure dome, big city of light, so nice they said it twice. For the only way to win is sweat and sacrifice. See everything move at a fast pace, make a fast break in the last place. It's just a state of mind. All you need for success, you'll find. New York City.
Welcome back to Championship Week presented by Dick's Sporting Goods, the 2010 Big East Championship presented by New York Life here at Madison Square Garden. Villanova and Marquette tied at 30. Marquette shot just 35% from the field, but in a tie game with Villanova, winner moves on to play Georgetown tomorrow. The Hoyas beat Syracuse earlier today. Back with Fran Fraschilla, Doris Burke. I'm Dave Fash. Beth Mowen's here as well. And that first half for Villanova, a lot like Syracuse's first half, shot great, but 10 turnovers.
10 turnovers, and Scotty Reynolds only 5 points. Keep in mind, he has been absolutely huge in the second half of Big East games this year.
Meanwhile, not a lot of people knew about Darius Johnson Odom of Marquette before the season, but he's been great all year, and including today.
You can get caught up, and Jay Wright touched on this with Beth Mullins right before the end of the half, and how many threes they make, and that's a major part of Buzz Williams. It's almost like looking at a mirror image of yourself. You talk about conference tournaments meaning something. I thought this guy could have easily been coach of the year in the Big East. His intensity level, the amount of preparation, the passion he shows, Fran.
Love it. Yep.
And we look at our first half stats brought to you by New York Life. Marquette missed its last 5 from 3-point land, still hit 5, and Johnson Odom had 3 of those. Scotty Reynolds in the first half had just 5 points. Corey Stokes off the bench had 11. We mentioned he loves to play at Madison Square Garden. Has had some big games here, and he'll start the second half. Yeru, who started the game, will begin the second half on the bench. Beat Marquette in the quarterfinals at the 2009 Big East Championship. Beat him twice during the regular season in close games. It appears we've got another close one here in New York. Fisher got it back. Called for the offensive foul, and that's his third. Let's check in with Beth Mullins.
Caught up with Buzz Williams just as he was coming out onto the court, guys. And a couple of things he was real pleased with. Limiting the paint points, only 6 for Villanova. He credited that to good ball pressure from their guards. And then forcing the 10 turnovers. He thought their help defense had to stay as good as it was in the first half. And playing the guys before the catch on defense, in particular Scotty Reynolds, who only had 5 shots in that first half.
Did a pretty good job on Reynolds as Acker fires at 2. Missed it. Rebound Reynolds.
Now, if I'm Jay Wright, I'm not going to worry about Scotty Reynolds because he averages over 13 points a game in the second half of Big East contests.
He's got a knack for affecting the game at crucial junctures. It wouldn't shock us if he does today.
And that is, by the way, double his scoring average from the first half. About 6 points per game in the first, 13 per game in the second in league games. And here he goes again, finding Fisher for an open three.
That Steve Nash, drive the baseline, throw, don't pick it up right away, see what you got.
Or Corey Fisher shooting over 50% from three the last half of the season. Butler in the lane, tough shot, won't drop, rebounded by Stokes. Here's the other Corey Stokes for three. I know that Corey Haim and Corey Feldman were a pretty good duo. These two much better. Stokes and Fisher with a couple of threes to start the half for Villanova.
Now Stokes picking up where he left off. The first one, Fisher gets it off the Scotty Reynolds dribble and probe the defense. And this guy, he was so good in the first half. Let's start him here in the second. Let's get him going.
Villanova and Marquette met in the quarterfinals of the Big East Championship a year ago. The Wildcats were down one. Reggie Redding on the drive to Dwayne Anderson beats the buzzer and beats Marquette. Anderson's only field goal of the game. Villanova wins by one. They played two close games this year. Final margin, a victory for Villanova, and both of those contests was two as we look at our Subway Fresh Take. We'll see if we have another fantastic finish here today.
Sometimes you got to put on that magic hat and be a lucky cat. Villanova got the end game last year. They got the Scotty Reynolds prayer this year. My men from Villanova.
Reggie Redding made the pass last year to Anderson for the game-winning hoop. Corey Fisher and Corey Stokes, each with a three to start the second stanza. Villanova leads Marquette by six.
Well, Villanova's done a much better job of keeping Marquette out of that dribble drive game into the lane. It's taking longer and longer on the shot clock.
5 seconds to shoot for Hayward. With one on the timer, they get off a shot. Kubion hits a three. How many times have they beaten the shot clock buzzer today?
How about the awareness of Hayward to know when he's doubled, the likely man open is on the far side of the court.
And Reggie Redding did about as much defensively as you could.
Yeru inside strip. It'll stay Villanova ball. Georgetown awaits the winner of that game. And in case you're just joining us, the Hoyas beat Syracuse. Arinze Onowaku hurt his knee in that game, but ESPN.com reporting that the Syracuse doctor says it's a problem that Onowaku has had in the past, that x-rays were negative, and he's been able to play through that problem the last couple of years. So we'll see if Onowaku is indeed available for Syracuse in the NCAA tournament.
Watch how those white jerseys shrink the court anytime the ball's put on the floor.
Butler on the drive, yes! One.
Dave, they started the second half trying to isolate Jimmy Butler on that wing because he's such an effective driver, and watch him use his body to wall off Redding to the rim. Hangs, Redding gets there, can't get it all the way. Jimmy Butler's going to go for an old-fashioned three.
Redding picking up his first and the second on Villanova in the half. Jimmy Butler's had some big shots this year. The game winner at Connecticut, time running out, and the game winner at St. John's in the final seconds of overtime. Six straight points by Marquette after six in a row by Villanova to start the half. Fisher, double team, finds Stokes. And Corey Stokes hits another one. He's got 16.
The guys around the player being doubled have got to reposition and get in the line of vision of the guy being trapped.
Hayward with a catch. And Hayward able to get to the rim. He's got nine.
Boy, how good is he? Posts up, seals his man away from the rim, and a great delivery.
Marquette led by nine, but Villanova came back on the strength of great shooting. Yeru
gives the Wildcats a two-point lead. That's his first field goal.
Oh, great switch.
Mismatch on the box, so Yeru trying to get down there to give some assistance, but Scotty Reynolds is checking.
Yeah,
yeah, there's the switch. Good switch.
Yeah, Reynolds picking up Hayward. Or make that Redding, I should say, as Kubion misses, and Yeru cleans the glass. Yeru calling for him. And he's fouled by Hayward, and that's the third on Lazar Hayward.
Well, we saw what the big fella Yeru can do. He'll be a weapon for Jay Wright, but Lazar Hayward already knowing how to operate down low. The senior from Buffalo is a mismatch nightmare.
You can make it here. You'll make it anywhere. New York City.
Back in New York, Villanova on top of Marquette by two, and you think he's a character? Wait till you check out all the guys we roll out on Selection Sunday for Bracketology. It all starts at 6 Eastern with SportsCenter, then wall-to-wall coverage with our game day crew, Dick Vitale, Bracketology, ESPN, and at 9 Eastern, ESPN Films 30 for 30 series. This one's going to be good. Reggie Miller against the New York Knicks and Spike Lee. And it all happened right here at Madison Square Garden.
I guarantee you the video of Reggie grabbing his throat and looking at Spike Lee as if saying the Knicks choke, that's going to somehow make that. That'll be a fascinating one. Those are so well done, those 30 for 30s.
Yeah, the one on the USFL was outstanding. Personally, that was my favorite of the ones I've seen.
I like the Baltimore, the Baltimore Colts band. I think Barry Levinson produced it or directed it.
Fran, how far has this young man come? I mean, he misses such a significant part of the season and doesn't have a ton of basketball experience, but he looks like a player.
Well, and I know he knows five languages, but putting him into the Big East Conference in the middle of the season without any experience is like being stuck in a trigonometry class, you know, halfway through the semester. He's had to really pick things up very quickly.
Moved to the United States in 2007, went to Montrose Christian, which produced Kevin Durant. Yeru was a soccer player until age 14. He's from West Africa. Great pass by Hayward to Butler, and Marquette back within two.
He's crafty, and this is why I think this guy has an opportunity to make a roster next year. He's smart, he understands the game. You think about the fact that Bruce Bowen, now our colleague at ESPN, made a long career in the NBA by being able to guard and make three-point shots, standstill three-point shots. There's got to be a place for Hayward.
And he's defending Yeru right now. Fisher off the glass, no. And Hayward got the rebound away from Yeru. Here he is on the other end. And that pass intercepted by the crafty Reynolds. Here's Reynolds in transition. Buries it through!
Don't be surprised if Scotty Reynolds starts to heat up. A week ago, he had no points at Cincinnati, and he ended up with 17 critical ones down the stretch. He loves the second half.
Kubion down the lane, and a foul called on Yeru, his first.
Scotty Reynolds will tell you it took me two or three years to get efficient and not just get off shots. So in the first half, he doesn't score. Does he let it bother him? No. He simply comes down, trails in transition three. And again, part of his inefficiency early in his career was the amount of weight that was on his shoulders to produce points.
Well, the thing I love about Scotty Reynolds, to me, he's the link. Hmm. He's the link from the team before him in 06, the Foys, the Allen Rays, the Kyle Lowrys. He had to step in as a freshman that year, Doris. Remember, we got 40
yes,
at UConn in a critical game for Villanova's chances. He brought them back in his sophomore year in an NCAA tournament game against Clemson. Last year against Pittsburgh in the regional final. He has always been a big game player from the moment he came on campus.
And his minutes can be down this year, and thus the field goal percentage comes up because your legs are a little bit fresher. And you know, Jay Wright basically told Mike Nardi, Curtis Sumter, in those years you're talking about, he said, listen, guys, you're going to have to play more efficiently because I'm going to turn Scotty Reynolds loose to be a playmaker. And sometimes he's going to take some bad shots, and we as a team collectively are going to live with it.
I remember talking to Scotty Reynolds of the McDonald's All-American game. He found out while he was there that Kelvin Sampson had taken the Indiana job. He was all set to go to Oklahoma. Ends up at Villanova, and Jay Wright is glad he did. Led him to the Final Four a year ago. Out of bounds off of Marquette. Giroux with great hustle.
Boy, you're talking about a guy that goes 6'10", 6'11", about 250. Watch the hustle by Mufiaru. He's from Benin on the west coast of Africa. Only been here just a short few years. And how about the recruiting trip Jay Wright made? 20 hours to get there to meet his family.
Muftal, one of 13 children in his family, as a foul is called on the inbound pass on Johnson Odom. That's his first foul. Second on Marquette.
Not bad that Scotty Reynolds comes here as a last resort and is going to end up maybe as the school's all-time leading scorer.
Came into today 59 points behind Kerry Kittles, who led Villanova to its only Big East tournament championship in 1995. Here's Stokes. Another Villanova three. Stokes with four. Make that five three-pointers in the ballgame.
A little trickeration by Antonio Pena. It was a peekaboo play. Everybody thought he was going to hand the ball off, and he kept it.
Stokes had 22 at the Big East tournament against Syracuse 2 years ago, 20 against Marquette. Last year, he's got 19 today. Acker able to answer as it spins home with a three.
Well, what would you expect from Marquette? Well, you know this game's going down to the wire. Every other game has for them in the league, it seems like.
13 games out of 31 played have been decided by 3 points or less. Marquette's won 7 of those. Wayne's fouled. Third team foul on the Golden Eagles. And that's the third on Acker.
Doris, you've watched Antonio Pena for 3 years. I don't think he could have made that move right there as a freshman or sophomore. The fake, the drive into the lane, and then the kick out. Much improved, as Dave talked about. He gives you a little bit of everything now, not just toughness.
Well, you talked about the link amongst the guards. He has the link to Dante Cunningham. Worked against Dante every day in practice. I'm not sure before last year if Dante would have been considered a guy who could start in the NBA in his rookie season, but that's exactly what's happened.
Well, it's funny you say that because Dante Cunningham, Dwayne Anderson, and Orenzi Anuaku all played on the same summer league team, and ironically, none of them were heavily recruited.
Is there anything you don't know in basketball?
I'm glad we're not talking international players because he just completely blow us out of the water here because he knows everybody overseas.
Well, Mufiaru's got a teammate back in Benin. No,
oh,
just
boy. No, you're not kidding. That's the problem. Marquette with the ball down 6. Johnson Odom, beautiful spin, threw it in off the window. First bucket of the second half for Johnson Odom. He's got 13 points for the game. Waynes finds Pena. Good pass, but Pena blew the leg. Hayward got position on Waynes. And Hayward in double figures with 11. Timeout Villanova.
I would say this is not his best defensive lineup. This is the one you were talking about in the first half. That's your good offensive unit where you could spread the floor. But that's twice now they've gotten shots at the rim, Marquette.
Winner of this game will play Georgetown. Villanova, by the way, is 0-5 against Georgetown in the Big East Championship. The Hoyas, the 8 seed, beating Syracuse earlier today. That game will be tomorrow at 7 Eastern on ESPN. We still have 2 more games tonight in quarterfinal play. Pittsburgh, Notre Dame, West Virginia, Cincinnati. After Notre Dame beating Seton Hall last night, are the Irish a lock, and is Marquette a lock regardless of the outcome today?
Well, I think they are, but I think what's interesting about Notre Dame and Pittsburgh, Dave, is about 2 weeks ago, Notre Dame thrashed Pittsburgh without Luke Arangoti. And for all those people who say, well, they're better without Luke, obviously that's silly. But the confidence of Notre Dame's players, with when you talk about Jackson and Hansborough,
Carlton Scott,
they are a better team because Luke Arangoti got hurt. That's what I know.
I agree, no question.
Secure their spot, brought to you by New York Life. How about Marquette? Are the Golden Eagles in no matter what happens here?
Oh, I think they are. I think they proved it over the course of the regular season in the league. It's not like they're playing like chopped liver today.
Joe Lenardi, a bracketologist for ESPN, latest has 8 Big East teams in. Syracuse as a 1 seed as Pena cleans it up, scores, and a foul on Marquette. Timeout on the floor. The Wildcats lead it by 4.
Make it in.
Villanova by 4. Grand Central Station has assisted in many a departure. Syracuse heading home after losing in the Big East Championship quarterfinal to Georgetown earlier today. Did they lose one of their starters, Orenze Onowaku? Here's Syracuse coach Jim Boeheim earlier.
Well, he's got a strain. We don't know for sure if it's any more than that. We'll find out Monday. We'll try to find out tomorrow when we go home, get the MRI tomorrow.
ESPN.com reporting as you look at the injury by Onowaku that x-rays negative according to the Syracuse team doctor, and that the issue that he's got is something he's dealt with the last couple of years and been able to play through. Joe Lenardi updating his bracketology at ESPN.com even with the injury and the loss. As you see, Arinze's mom Anastasia has Syracuse still as a 1 seed.
I'm glad, because the sample size, Fran, with what Syracuse did all year, I don't think you could take them out of the 1 seed. There's not enough good 2 seeds.
I agree with you. I think it's a body of work all year. You know, I don't know if you guys, Dave, if you've been to the new Mello Center, the new basketball facility up at Syracuse, but they have a unbelievable place and a great training room. And when I was there a couple weeks ago, the guy that spent the most time in there during the afternoon was Orenze Onowaku, making sure he was taking care of those knees.
Beth Mullins telling us that she spoke recently with Orenze's mom, Anastasia, and she did confirm that x-rays are negative, and she thinks he'll be fine for the NCAA tournament. So great news for Syracuse, as Onowaku has been such a key guy for them this year. Marquette down 4. Johnson Odom unable to score, but it'll go to the line after another good look by Hayward.
Yeah, I mean, that's all off his action. They are revving him. In other words, they're doubling Hayward on the catch to try to prohibit him from being a scorer. But you know what? What does he do? He's simply finding the guys around him, Fran, and he doesn't panic under duress of that trap.
You think it's, so you're saying it's not his first rodeo over there?
Yes.
You think he's been double teamed before, is what you're saying, right?
Well, if you have somebody who has the pulse, the mindset to invite the double team, it's a strength of your team, because you're now taking 2 defenders for you. You'll pick a defense apart.
Yuru back on the floor, Pena to the bench, 14 fouls per side.
Well, so now does Jay Wright make the adjustment and maybe switch and go back to a better defensive unit with Yuru on the floor? You certainly have more rim protection with him on the floor.
Well, I think the dilemma for Jay Wright now and the rest of this tournament is going to be, do I play for better offense or do I play to have better defense? And it could be a situation that changes every different point during a game.
3 meetings between these two have been decided by 2 points or less. 3-point margin right now as Redding is pushed by Butler, his second, 5th on the Golden Eagles.
I personally think, Doris, that more mismatches are created when you play smaller than when you play bigger. But having Pena and Yuru on the glass will help them versus certain teams in the tournament.
Yuru for traveling. 12th Villanova turnover, just 4 by Marquette.
So you've got different lineups. that are good at different things, then it's just a feel based on what you're seeing as a coach as to what lineup you're using.
Sometimes you call it feel, sometimes you call it confusion.
Johnson Odom exploding to the basket, and he's fouled. As good of a three-point shooter as he is, he's just as fun to watch taking it to the rim. Giroux picks up the foul, his second, fifth on Nova.
Do you not look at this guy? It's a star in the making, Johnson Odom.
Well, we saw it back in early January, and I had a chance to see it back in November. When you think of Acker, Kubion, and Johnson Odom, and they were understudies. And obviously, Johnson Odom wasn't here, but Acker and Kubion understudies to three great Marquette players, three of the top eight scorers in the history of the school. To see what they've done this year is remarkable.
Yeah, Jarrell McNeil, one of those guys. He is the all-time leading scorer. Hayward closing in on him, and Wes Matthews, another player who's now starting for the Utah Jazz. There he has been for Utah. 1 point game midway through the second half. Winner plays Georgetown tomorrow night, 7 Eastern, ESPN, in the Big East semis. Here's Stokes, been the leading scorer for Villanova. Here he turns it over, and an intentional foul called on Redding. Two shots and the ball for Marquette.
That's a result. That steal is a result of two things. Ball pressure by Acker out front, and then the denial. Franny, how about that? You're pressuring Scotty Reynolds like heck, and Jay's upset about the intentional call.
Well, what I love particularly on that play, Doris, is Kubion just would not let Scotty come and get it.
And there's no clear path to the basket foul in college like there is in the pros, but that's essentially what that was, right? He had a clear path to the basket. Redding grabbed him, and so they called the intentional foul.
Well, exactly. You have to play the basketball, and you have to do it in a way that doesn't allow excessive contact.
You don't always see that call made, though.
No, I agree, but I think officials are more and more conscious of that because it really puts the offense in a serious disadvantage.
I like the call because I agree. Otherwise, it's a layup.
There's the steal, and it happened because Kubion would not let Scotty Reynolds get that ball back.
Butler 1 out of 2, and Marquette ball tie game at 52. Our sixth tie of the day. Johnson Odom's pass broken up by Reynolds. Held ball, it'll stay Marquette basketball on the alternate possession arrow.
He's frustrated with himself. That's one thing he's going to get better at. Once he gets into the lane, you have a couple of seconds there to be patient. It's like he rushed the play because he was concerned he was in the paint, but that's just repetition, something the Villanova guards do so well. They get in there, they take their time, they're surveying the defense.
Well, you remember, because Buzz Williams doesn't have that true low-post score, obviously Hayward can do it. So much of the offense in the lane is generated by those drives.
Buzz Williams working that baseline again. Marquette ball, 24 to shoot.
Got another mismatch.
Hayward on Fisher. Fisher yelling out switch. Yep. Stokes recognizes it. Now Redding switches. With 5 on the shot clock, Johnson Odom with a 2.
The problem with switching is eventually you're going to be able to, as an offense, exploit a mismatch. And Pena had to guard against Odom, Johnson Odom's dribble.
First lead this half for Marquette. Is it Reynolds' time? Not on that shot. Loose ball. Acker out of there with it. 3-on-2 for Marquette. Johnson Odom pull up. No. Reynolds rebounds. Here's Fisher. Finds Pena. Villanova has it tied at 54. The mismatch, Fisher on him. Johnson Odom, good catch. That pass was off the mark. Kubion's three. Good! His third three. He had three threes yesterday. He was a career 4 of 17 from three-point land in the Big East tournament prior to this week.
And Buzz Williams going to love that paint touch.
Reynolds, he got his man in the air, but then he passed the ball. So it's a coming foul, ball out of bounds. Foul on Kubion is his second. Marquette leads by three on this three by David Kubion. Only Buzz Williams players can read that grease board. Back here at the Garden, Marquette by three as we go inside the play.
Well, that might not have made sense, but they do not have ball stoppers. Watch the ball movement here from Kubion to Acker to Johnson Odom, and that sets up the paint touch off the drive, and now the dish back to the man that started it, and Kubion calmly knocks down the open three.
Marquette shooting 64% from the field this half. Buzz Williams is 37 years old. And, Jay Wright at Villanova's had some opportunities to leave, and he stayed at Villanova. As Marquette's made 9 of his last 11. There's going to be a lot of people interested in Buzz Williams because of the way he relates to his players, how hard they play, and the way they practice, and also how he handles himself off the court.
Marquette has made a huge investment in basketball, going back to Tom Crean. And I think they understand what they have, and they wouldn't have hired him. It turned out to be very inspired hiring.
Fisher fouled. They go to the line for two. Seventh team foul on Marquette, and that is now 4 on Maurice Acker. They only got 2 bench points, Marquette, so they need Acker out there. We'll see if Buzz Williams leaves him on the court. He's going to right now. And Fisher is 79% free throw shooter.
What do you think about a guy, Doris, who's 6'1", who comes into this tournament shooting about 160 free throws on the season?
Love that. We said it yesterday. Great offensive players figure out a way to get to the rim. And they revel in those and-one situations, and that's Corey Fisher.
Both he and Reynolds do a good job of getting to the free throw line. Winner of this game plays Georgetown tomorrow night in the semis. We still have 2 more games tonight from Madison Square Garden. It's 7-9 Eastern on ESPN. Johnson Odom turns it over. The pick by Redding. Here's Reynolds on the other end.
Now watch Kubion and Reynolds. Oh, you didn't want him to catch it.
Reynolds can't get the bounce. Pena slapped out of there by Butler. It'll go to Marquette.
You see what I mean about Butler being a little bit impatient in the paint? He's done some good things, but there are times where he rushes it. Had he just jump-stopped a little bounce pass down, he's too much in a hurry. And again, this is his first trip through the Big East, Fran, but that's something that will come with time and repetition.
Absolutely. Experience is the best teacher.
Only 8 points for Reynolds. He struggled in Villanova's regular season finale against West Virginia, just 5 of 16 from the field, 1 of 9 from 3, 17 points in that game. Excellent ball movement by Marquette. Villanova rotates, so Butler drives and kicks. Johnson Odom, another one! 4-3, he's got 21.
Come on now. See, that's a great example. They have no ball stoppers. How many teams have you seen this year where a good player would hold on to it? They move it.
Reynolds leaning in. Butler got the block. Marquette ball and a 4-point lead.
Yesterday, they were self-critical after their basketball game. They said, we became too stagnant, too passive late. We've got to do a better job attacking when they have the lead. Did they learn? We're 24 hours later.
St. John's came roaring back. Marquette hung on to win by 2. Hayward inside. 6-point Marquette lead. Timeout, Villanova. Thank you.
This is a guy from Raleigh, North Carolina. Tell the truth if you're a fan at home. You've never heard of this guy. Junior college All-American from Hutchinson in Kansas. He joins Marquette as a sophomore. He had to step in and fill in some big shoes, guys like McNeil, Matthews, James. But this guy gives you the inside, the outside, the athleticism, and the explosiveness.
And let's remember this also about Buzz Williams. Junior Cadogan was supposed to step in and in all likelihood would have been the starting lead guard. So, yes, you replaced all those top 10 scorers and the guy who without question would have been your starting point guard. And here they are with a 6-point advantage against a team that's ranked in the top 10 and was for long stretches in the top 5 in the country.
They were also planning on Jerron Maimon having an impact this year, a freshman, but he ended up not working out there. Transferred to Tennessee.
Yeah, he didn't play hard enough, in my opinion. He got frustrated early. He's going to go to Tennessee and play for Bruce Pearl. Good for him. He'll learn how to play hard there. But he didn't play hard enough for this team.
Marquette on a 14-4 run over the last 5 minutes to open up a 6-point lead. 5.5 to play. Hayward, who's one of the league leaders in steals, almost got one there. Instead, he picks up his fourth personal foul. So Hayward and Acker both with four.
A good big hedge. He's trying to give some assistance. And he goes for the strip and... Really? you can't smile about that because you're not coaching right now.
Exactly.
You're sitting over here with us.
And if you're Buzz Williams, you keep Hayward out there. He's got four fouls.
You know, you have no other answers, really. Joseph Fultz, maybe. The only thing you might do here is get him off the court for a minute or so, but you might as well dance with who brung you. I learned that in Texas, Gord.
Fisher hits the front end of the 1-1. That's the 8th Marquette team foul. We've seen already one team with a double bye. Syracuse lose today. Will it happen again? With Marquette on top of Villanova by 5. Teams with the double byes were 2-2 last year. And Jim Boeheim was quoted as saying he thinks it's awful. He doesn't like that setup. May not be alone after this tournament as Pena gets the rebound following the miss by Johnson Odom. Off the foot of Villanova Marquette ball.
David Kubion has been involved in a lot of plays on the defensive end of the floor, or in that particular instance, pushing up into the full court situation. You talked about his deny. Here he recognizes that Scotty's not anticipating pressure. Look at Buzz. Go ahead. He's coached. Might as well officiate a little bit.
Remember that scrum at the end of the first half when
yes.
they dove on the floor? Kubion has been a thorn in Scotty Reynolds' side this afternoon.
Buzz Williams has spent as much time on the court as Kubion. He actually is off of it right now. He was standing on the court there during the inbounds pass. Here's Johnson Odom. You bet! His fifth three! And they're going to look at it to see if his foot was on the line.
Forget about star in the making. We've got a star on the floor in Darius Johnson Odom.
And did you notice Buzz Williams quickly got his team together because he's getting a free timeout right now.
As the officials determine whether it's a 2 or a 3, if it stands, it will be an 8-point lead for Marquette, a career high 24 points. Or if it's 23, it's still a career high for Johnson Odom. Could you guys tell there?
Oh, it's good. They counted it.
Well, he's unique in a lot of ways, and I'm drawing comparisons to Sam Young. One, he's a lefty. So normally you're closing out to the right hand to contest a shot. With him, you've got to remember it's the other way. There wasn't a close out there anyway. But his lift, his shot fake is such an effective thing. He can go off the dribble in either direction. Obviously very strong to his left hand. He can drain the jump shot. Athletically, he can board it, Fran. I mean, this guy has got star, big-time player potential.
You know what I like about him? He's got the extra gear when he puts it on the floor.
And Marquette now 5 of 5 from three-point land in the second half. They're one of the best three-point shooting teams in the country. Reynolds, terrific move in the lane. Villanova back within 6, 4.5 to play. And great defensive play by Stokes, and then a Marquette foul. Villanova will shoot free throws. They're the number one free throw shooting team in the Big East, and that's the 9th team foul on Marquette, so a 1-1 situation.
You know, you try to put all those close games as a player into your bank and withdraw from it at the end of the season. But here's something for Marquette to be thinking about. They've lost two close games to Villanova this year, so that will weigh on their mind a little bit.
And as we said in the first game, tough to beat a team three times in 1 year. Syracuse beat Georgetown twice during the regular season. Hoyas win today.
12 conference games, including yesterday, by Marquette, decided by 3 points or less. They've won 6 of their last 7 in that contest.
Hayward on the bench with 4. Acker also on the bench with 4 fouls.
Well, that was smart, and that was to Fran's point. Just get him out for a minute, get underneath the timeout situation under 4.
That's one of those where it looked like he took the extra step. I couldn't really tell.
Fisher in the lane. There's contact, no call. And 3 players hit the deck. And a Marquette foul. That's their 10th team foul.
Part of the reason Corey Fisher had so much room to drive is the defense was concerned about Scotty Reynolds coming off that down screen again, and it gave him a chance to go one-on-one and dump it down to Pena.
Second personal on Fulce. Pena, 70% free throw shooter at the stripe.
When Scotty Reynolds comes off the screen, he's going to occupy 2 defenders on the weak side. That allows Corey Fisher to operate one-on-one in the middle of the floor and then dump it down to Pena.
Hayward back out there with 4 personal fouls. Maurice Acker also on the court with 4. 4:09 to play. Pena gets the next free throw. And Villanova back within 2. And the fans from Philly starting to get into it here at the Garden. Acker keeping the dribble. Johnson Odom.
Another impatient move in the paint. He's been sensational. If there's one criticism, it's that. Slow down, big fella. Nobody can take it from you. You're too strong.
Acker fell down. Did a great job to get it to a teammate, Buzz Williams says. We better talk it over. Timeout with 7 to shoot. Each team with a pair of timeouts. 16 fouls on Villanova, 10 on Marquette. The arrow favors Villanova. Take a look at the ACC tournament bracket. Miami upsets Wake Forest. So tomorrow in the quarterfinals, it'll be Duke, Virginia at noon Eastern. Virginia Tech, Miami at 2. Georgia Tech, North Carolina tonight on ESPN2 at 7. Guys, if Duke were to lose the ACC tournament and West Virginia or Ohio State plays well in their respective conference tournaments, can one of those teams get a 1 seed?
Well, let me call Joey Brackets right now. But, I just think there's still a lot of Rubik's Cube stuff to go on these next couple days with who wins and who loses.
I talked to one West Virginia official yesterday who said they don't think they're a 1 seed. They don't feel like a 1. Well, we'll see. With Syracuse out of the Big East tournament now, West Virginia playing Cincinnati tonight. That's the final game of 4 here on ESPN, 9 Eastern tonight. You saw the record there. Games decided late and close contest. Great steal by Fisher. Oh, he almost moved the lane, but he ties the game nonetheless.
He expected contact from Hayward, but Hayward smartly knows he's got 4.
Butler right back at you. 3-point opportunity.
Great job by Johnson Odom not to hang his head. He threw the inbounds that got picked off. Don't hang your head. There's plays to be made.
Well, Marquette has played 13 games this year, decided by 3 points or less as Fisher ties the game, but Golden Eagles bounce right back. 4 of their last 6 games are gone to overtime. Are we headed there again?
Go on the first half there.
John here, Georgetown awaits the winner of this game. Syracuse knocked off. Will Lorenzo Anoa'aku be available for the NCAA tournament? X-rays negative on his right knee, but the team doctor saying that it's a quad tendon injury. They'll have an MRI in Syracuse as he flies back with the team. Two games tonight, Pitt, Notre Dame at 7 Eastern, West Virginia, Cincinnati, 9 Eastern, both on ESPN.
This one guy I would have liked to have seen with his career completely healthy. I mean, he's been effective. His field goal percentage is exceptional, but he's battled injuries throughout his career on Anoa'aku.
Butler completes the three-point play. Marquette by three.
Well, and keep your eye on number 10 in the blue, Kubion. He's done a terrific job on Scotty Reynolds tonight. 10 points total, only five in the second half.
Fisher drives. Great hang and score off the window.
That's the beauty of that. You've got multiple options, man. And Corey Fisher is similar to Scotty in that he's a game-time player.
Well, he knows that Scotty's man cannot help on the drive, so there's more room. It's like I mentioned earlier, 4-on-4 in hockey, more space to drive.
Johnson, Odom, no. And two Villanova players had a chance to get the rebound and could not. Darius Johnson Odom, a career high 24 points. He's been the star in this one.
Villanova just put so much pressure on you defensively to stay in front of the dribble driver. Not many teams have been able to do it. You know what's coming, Fran.
Oh, you do, and you know, think of the adjustment Jay Wright's made. He stayed small now down the stretch of this game. The matchup.
Here's Butler off the bounce. He's hit some big shots at the end of games this year to beat Connecticut and St. John's. And he now has 14 in this game. At the last five Marquette points. Stokes has had a big day. Counted for three to tie it at 70. 6-3 for him. 22 points, a career high.
It's a shell game for Villanova. You take away Reynolds and Fisher, and you still have Stokes.
Their last three meetings came down to the final shot. We might be headed that way again here at the Garden. Under two to play, tied at 70. Hayward answers with a three of his own.
Image teams. They're built the same way. They go a lot of the same stuff.
How about 5'8 Mo Acker guarding 6'5 Corey Stokes right now?
Marquette has hit 11 threes in this game. And they lead by three. Redding spins. Butler may have gotten a piece of it there. Marquette ball. Marquette 6 of 6 in the half from behind the arc. We'll see if they look for it again here. Try to go inside with a three-point lead as we hit the one-minute mark. Winner to play Georgetown tomorrow night in the semis. Shot clock at 7. Here's Butler. And Stokes got tripped up by Kubion. But they get Villanova for a foul. Fisher pushed Kubion. And that's 4 on Corey Fisher. 18 foul. So Kubion, who during the regular season shot just 16 free throws, will have a 1-1.
You know, when you win and lose close games, plays like that are the difference. David Kubion with just a hustle effort to come up with that ball and a foul.
Marquette by 4.
If he makes this, Brandon, do you push up a little bit and come with any soft pressure?
You know, maybe that little 1-2-2 zone, Doris, but once that ball gets over the press, then you give Villanova a lot of room to drive. I would be very smart, play 20 feet and in right now.
And there it is. They're going to come up. They can use some time.
Yep, but not too much. See, it's a nuisance press.
40 seconds left in the game. 25 to shoot. Redding finds Pena underneath, puts it in. 3-point game. Timeout Villanova. One left for Jay Wright.
Corey Stokes, we asked, does he like playing in Madison Square Garden? Good solid screen by Redding. Little jab step gets the defender reacting backwards. He's got a lot of size advantage there. Makes that an easy release point.
Well, Marquette comes right back. You know it's going to be Lazar Hayward who stepped up time and time again this year for Buzz Williams. You want to go down. If you're going to go down fighting, you go down with a guy who Buzz Williams says is the heart and soul of our team.
He had the big three, and he had a huge rebound on the last possession. Before that, made basket by Pena. So yesterday, he made the two winning plays at the end.
Now, a lot of people thought Hayward should have been first team All Big East. It's something that's voted on by the coaches. He was named second team, even though a lot of people thought he was even the MVP of the Big East. Wes Johnson won Player of the Year honors.
How many times when you play in a league like this that games are decided by one or two possessions, press offense is critical.
If Villanova does not get a steal, it will look to foul immediately. Hayward's an 84% free throw shooter. You don't want to foul him unless you have to, and they do there. It'll be a 1-1. That's the 19th foul on Villanova. Georgetown awaits the winner of this game tomorrow in one semi. We also have two more quarterfinals tonight on ESPN from the Garden. Hayward, the number two all-time scorer at Marquette behind Jarrell McNeil. During league games, he shot 86% at the free throw line this year.
Think of guys like Butch Lee and Bo Ellis, Dean Memminger, of course recent stars like Dwayne Wade and Travis Diener. This guy's going to be able to put himself right there at the top with the greats of Marquette history.
Of course, Doc Rivers is the second free throw good for Hayward. It's a 5-point game. Are you going quick two again if you're Villanova? You start to think about a three.
Get to the rim as quick as you can. Open three, you'll take it, but get there.
Fisher did, and he put it in a Marquette foul. That's one way to get a three.
I don't think he touched him. Now, it's Lazar Hayward's fifth foul, and if I'm wrong, I'll tell you. But I'm not sure Lazar Hayward made any contact here. Take a look.
It's actually Acker who committed the foul, but he's gone. Nonetheless, that's his fifth.
All right, there you go. That's a good call by John Cowell. Got him on the arm.
One of the best in the business right there making that call.
And not that you want to lose either guy, but certainly Hayward would be a bigger loss. Acker, an excellent three-point shooter. But he is fouled out.
He's come with Dwight Bikes.
I'll tell you what now, Acker has always been this year their best decision maker. So now you basically have three guards on the floor for Marquette.
And Corey Fisher at the free throw line, 79% shooter on the year. Just 5 of 8 in this game, trying to complete the three-point play. In and out. They got a foul. And Pena can't get to Kobe on. He lost it, but they get Reynolds for the personal. He thought he had all ball. It's only two on Reynolds, but it is the 10-team foul, so Kobe on will shoot two.
Not an easy job refereeing in the Big East tournament. Take a look, Norris. Let's see. What do you think?
He just loses that basketball.
Boy. It looks that way.
You can see Scotty's face. It's contact, but it's after he's released the ball, and that's an out-of-control dribbler.
Kubion missed the first one. He needs one to make it a two-possession game. Four-point lead for Marquette. Quick two or three if you're Villanova.
I think you still can get the quick two unless it's an open three.
Fisher lost it. Now with 10 seconds left, got to shoot quickly. Here's Pena with six. Pena puts it in, but only 4.5 in the clock. Villanova calls its final timeout. 2-point lead for Marquette with 4.5 to play in another close game between Marquette and Villanova. We should not be surprised. In the quarterfinals of the Big East tournament last year, Marquette had a 1-point lead. Villanova ball. Reggie Redding made a great pass to Dwayne Anderson for his only field goal of the game. It beats the buzzer. Villanova wins by one. Then on January 2nd of this year, fancy dribbling by Scotty Reynolds hits the go-ahead shot with 18 seconds left. Bikes short with his attempt. Villanova wins that one. Then a week later, Marquette loses to Nova again in a close game, 78-76.
Lost to Nova two times by a total of 4 points. And again, Franny, they get out of the gates. They drop their first three conference games by such slim margins and heartbreaking fashion, and he never lost them, Buzz Williams.
Well, and Dave asked us early, is Marquette in? And I would ask you, Dave, given the eyeball test.
Definitely.
See what I mean?
Yeah, not even close. They're definitely in.
This, and I'll tell you, there's not a team I've seen all year that plays harder or is more prepared than Marquette. And there's some great coaching jobs being done out there, but none better than the job that's done here.
Yeah, I don't think there's any question. They easily pass the eye test.
So right now it looks like at least 8 in for the Big East, if you include Notre Dame there, which would match what the Big East did a couple years ago, putting 8 teams in the field.
Now, press offense, you can run the baseline. You have 2 timeouts left. See, they start at midcourt so they can break quickly to the ball.
Inbound to Hayward. They got a foul. They do. Took about a second off the clock. Hayward, an 84% free throw shooter. He'll have 2.
You know what you love about that, Doris? When you put everybody at midcourt, it forces the defense to defend you all 50 feet towards the ball, and it's not easy to deny a guy for that long.
That's correct. He's got a full head of steam. You're cut either direction off that full head of steam, and you know where you're going. The defense doesn't. I like that press offense.
We've already had one upset today at the Big East Championship. The 8th seed Georgetown beat the 1 seed Syracuse and awaits the winner of this one. Hayward got the bounce. 3-point lead for Marquette.
If this ball is missed, Marquette is going to rebound that ball. You see the time, and we saw it yesterday. 3 dribbles max. Throw it up towards the rim.
Second one. Marquette by 4. 3.2 on the clock. Here's Fisher. Marquette will not contest. Fisher misses. Marquette wins. The two teams that had the double bye are going home. Syracuse losing. Villanova losing. It'll be a Marquette-Georgetown semifinal tomorrow night on ESPN at 7. We've got 2 more quarterfinal games tonight. Coming up in 2 hours, it'll be Pitt and Notre Dame, followed by West Virginia and Cincinnati. Darius Johnson Odom with a career-high 24 points for Marquette. Lazar Hayward had 20, including some key free throws down the stretch as Marquette beats Villanova 80-76. Coming up next on ESPN, Jim Rome is burning. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Fran Fraschilla, Dorisberg, Beth Mowins, I'm Dave Pasch. So long for now from the Garden.